Hi everyone. Thank you for being with us this afternoon. Welcome to Vision Church of Lockhart Wednesday night Bible study. We are studying Christian philosophy, and we've been having an awesome time. And just welcome. We're going to get started. We're going to read and see what the Lord has for us this afternoon. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this afternoon for such a beautiful day and for a time, Father, that we can come aside and just rest in your presence, Lord. Let that hard day just run off of us, Lord, and that we can relax and just be in your presence, Father, and absorb everything that you have for us today in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. We left off, and in your book, in your little handout, is going to be page 179, and it's going to be the last paragraph. I'm not real sure if that's where we left off, but that's where we're going to start. I marked the page, but I didn't put which paragraph we started at or where we ended and where we began. And we're going to start where it says, there is not one particular theory of evolution. Can y'all find that? Okay. There is not one particular theory of evolution. There are many different theories. This is another problem with the whole evolution argument. Because even among evolutionists, they can't agree on which theory is correct. That's funny. In general, there are two categories of theories. Anti-theistic theories, like atheist, but it's anti-theistic theories, which basically state that our universe is here by a random accident and not because an intelligent being created it. The theistic theories, which hold that God did create the universe, but that evolution was still part of the equation. Yet another theory is intelligent design, which claims that there was some sort of being, not necessarily God, who created life. Biblical creationism, which views creation as a literal six-day event, and anti-theistic evolution are polar opposites of one another. While all these theories create an evolution spectrum in between, sadly, many Christians believe in one of the many non-biblical theories of evolution, holding creationism views that have subtly evolved away from the truth of Scripture. One of Satan's greatest tactics is to mix just enough truth with lies that we fall for the lies into deception. Over time, he has masterfully created hybrids between evolution and creationism. Theistic evolutionary theories, to the point where many Christians no longer have an untainted biblical view of how and when God formed the earth. Amen? That's that. An example of theistic evolution is the thought that God was responsible for the Big Bang, but that living beings evolved from that point. Another is that God did form each creature, including humans, as individual and universe and unique entities, but he did so millions of years ago. One version of this theory is called the gap theory, which states that there is actually millions of years of time between Genesis 1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and Genesis 2:1-2, which says, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. I got friends who love God and love his word, who have bought into this theory, but I can't subscribe to it. They believe that prior to Genesis 1:2, hundreds of millions of years existed, and during that time, all of the dinosaurs were alive, and there was an entire pre-existence Adamic civilization. They believe that what Genesis is explaining is actually a recreation, not an original creation of the earth. Have y'all heard those two different theories? Because there's some people that believe that the earth has just been here like 6,000 years, like when all the dispensations of life. And others believe that there's just millions and millions of years between Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. And, you know, that there was life here at one time, and then, you know, it was like frozen over or destroyed, and it was pure darkness. So there's two different viewpoints, you know, that people believe in that. And according to what you see in the Word of God, you know, there's two different views, but, you know, there's no reason to fight over which view is correct and which one you believe and which one you don't. We know that the earth was created by the Lord. Amen? And that's not something to argue or fight or debate. You know, everybody believe it the way they want. And as long as we know that the Word of God is true and that we've got a Savior, the important stuff. Amen? And then He's the soon coming King. Amen. Some Christians believe that there was a civilization in which Lucifer, whom we now call Satan, populated this earth and ruled over it. Lucifer then rebelled against God, and God destroyed the demonic civilization, causing the earth to become vain and void. Genesis 1, verse 2. They believe that when God told Adam and Eve to replenish the earth, in Genesis 1:28, the word replenish indicates that the earth was once vibrant, that it was once full of life, but then it was destroyed. To those who believe this, Genesis 1:28 is describing the recreation where Adam and Eve had to replenish or refill the earth. I admit that the word replenish can mean to fill again, but the word is used in a number of times in Scripture, and it's not talking about filling again. It simply means to fill. And he's getting this from the American Heritage Dictionary. In fact, all of the main translations of the Bible interpret this verse as be fruitful and fill the earth. It doesn't imply any of the meaning or refilling as something. I think it's just to fill like an action. It's a continual thing to fill. Too many people, including Christians, won't stand and speak against evolution because they've been told that it's an established fact. They're taught that evolution has been proven over and over. So often people are afraid to stand up and say anything about it. I was shocked to read an article that showed only a slight majority of pastors believe in biblical creationism. That's hard for me to believe it. I mean, who knows? But even among those who do believe it, the vast majority won't teach it because they fear how their people will respond. Actually, I heard an evangelist saying that, you know, he's at all times doing an altar call, you know, whether he's, preaching wherever or in a church, you know, and he said that one pastor apologized to him. He goes, I know you do altar calls at all your meetings, you know, but, you know, the church, everybody that was in the church were Christian. And he goes, don't ever apologize for that, because he goes, you'd be surprised. You know, you might think somebody's saved or they say they are, but they might not understand. I mean, they might have accepted, you know, the Lord or said something, but they didn't really understand or have it in their heart. I once was teaching a Bible study when we first started, and it was all Spanish. And I was saying something, and then I said something about accepting the Lord and being baptized. And she goes, wait a minute, what is that, accepting the Lord? And I looked back because she was baptized. She said she had been baptized. And I said, well, how did you get baptized? I said, who baptized you? You have to accept the Lord, you know, and, you know, I explained the whole thing to her. And I said, I can lead you in it right now. I said, but I want to know how you got baptized without someone leading you to the Lord. And she said she just went to a church and they had a list where their people wanted to be baptized. And so she signed up and she got baptized. But nobody asked her if she was saved or anything, you know. Yeah, because that's what we do. You know, we talk to the people there before they go to baptism and make sure, you know, that they understand. And so that's why it was a little odd for me that so it happens, you know. And even some pastors. I know I like to listen to it's called Revival TV or something like that. And they talk about all the old revivals, and there were a lot of pastors that started preaching and stuff, but they were never saved. They got saved later on. So I guess it can happen, you know? Yeah, because you can get a hold of the word and preach it and everything, but you have to have that intimacy and that, and accept the Lord and have him, because that's the only way your life's going to change. You can't change in your own will. There's no way in your flesh. You know, you need the Spirit of God to help you learn and change day by day. Amen. Okay. It says, but there are currently thousands upon thousands of scientists who don't buy into the lie of evolution. Some believe in intelligent design and others believe in biblical creationism. Even though we're all told that evolution is an established fact, they understand that it's not. It's merely a theory, and one with many holes. I believe in biblical creationism because I believe the Bible. The Word of God is sufficient for me to settle the issue of evolution versus creationism. But I also realize that there are many Christians, even some of you reading this book, who may honor God's word to a degree, but you also maybe even more so honor the natural and secular views you've been taught through the education system. For this reason, I also want to approach this topic from a place of logic and science, using experts in the field who've discovered evidence supporting biblical creationism to showcase the multitude of problems surrounding the theory of evolution. First, let me share some things from Scripture. I encourage you to read through Genesis 1 on your own. Do so with an open mind and an open heart, and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you through the Scripture. You'll see in Genesis that the Bible clearly states how God created the heavens and the earth. And here we're going to read Genesis 1, verse 1 to 3, and 14 and 16. Verse 14 and 16. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Let me hold on a minute. As you read this scripture, picture it in your mind. Can y'all do that? Because I'm reading it, and I see the dark, and I see just the Spirit of God. You're in a dark place. Use your imagination. It helps you understand, and you're there. Okay, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. Amen. In verse 3, God spoke light into existence. He spoke light into existence before he created the sun, the moon, and the stars. That's what the Bible says. In other words, he spoke light into existence before there was a place for light to come from. In verse 16. By this by itself totally disproves the Big Bang theory. These verses refute the theory because there was light before there was the sun, moon, and stars. The earth existed before the sun existed. There wasn't a bunch of matter that was just flung out in space. God created the earth, and on the third day, he made the sun, moon, and stars and placed them in the heavens to give light to the earth. If you believe the Bible's account of creation, there isn't room to believe evolution. Even if you believe there was a God who made the process of evolution happen, things didn't happen in the sequence that evolutionists say they did. The earth was created first. It was totally covered by water, and God spoke light into existence. It wasn't until the third day when he created the sun, moon, and the stars. This is hard to understand because if you need light, you flip a light switch and grab a flashlight. The light comes from that source. But Romans 4:17 tells us that God calleth those things which be not as though they are. Amen? Isn't that something? And we can do the same thing, right? We can all do the same thing. Thank you, Lord, for your word. God simply speaks things into existence. God spoke light into existence before he created a source for light. I know that's hard for our little peanut brains to wrap around and understand, but it doesn't disprove it. Just because we can't understand how God did something and because it's not the way we would have done it doesn't mean it isn't true. Dr. Ball once reported on a graduate project conducted at UCLA where the students used a flask of water and a boom box from which they could control the sound frequencies. They discovered that when they generated certain frequencies, a small bubble appeared in the center of a flask of water. They later found by experimentation that the bubble heated to 100,000 degrees, yet was self-insulating. As it heated, a full spectrum of light was emitted out the side of the bubble. Commenting on these results, Dr. Ball said, "What happened in this experiment totally verifies scripture. God said in the presence of that sphere of water that he had just created, let there be light, and there was light from sound." That is awesome. We know that physicists have learned that at the base of every physical entity are cells made of atoms, which in turn are made of subatom particles. All of these subatomic particles are vibrating. They have discovered that at the base of that vibration is sound. This confirms exactly what the Bible says. Everything we see was created by words, is maintained by words, and responds to words. Hallelujah. That is awesome. Right now, this about the sounds, you know. Sometimes, you know, around town, these people drive around with their boom boxes, and you hear all kinds of different sounds, some screeching sounds, and then you hear some Tejano sounds. And I'm going, whoa, you can hear them all. I can hear them in my office. And I mean, you can feel it in you. And one time this guy came, he was working on something at the shop, and he pulled up in his truck and he was playing some, it was demonic. To me, it sounded demonic. It was saying some nasty stuff and it was just like awful. And my spirit started, you know, it just, I could feel it. And I said, hold up. I got up and I went outside. Who's playing that music? You turn that radio off right now. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And I said, don't come up in here playing that kind of music. But it does. It affects your inside, you know. And words affect your feeling and what's going on. And you have to be real careful what you're listening to. There's a joke I just thought about, but I'll tell y'all after the class. Remind me and I'll think of it. There's some funny stuff. But anyway. All right. Where were we? One big problem I've always had with the pre-evolution argument is that it's based on the assumption that the universe goes from disorder to order and from simple to complex. But this is the exact opposite of what really happens in nature. As stated in the second law of the thermodynamics, in fact, the popular evolutionist and anti-creationist Isaac Asimov admitted, the second law of thermodynamics states that the amount of available work you can get out of the energy of the universe is constantly decreasing. This is true for everything in general, the universe all over. Another way of stating the second law then is the universe is constantly getting more disorderly. Viewed that way, we can see the second law all about us. Everything deteriorates, collapses, breaks down, wears out, all by itself. And that is what the second law is all about. This is totally contrary to the theory of evolution. The evolution everywhere, everything goes from very simple to incredible, complex, and sophisticated. This is not observable anywhere in nature. Dr. Bogg adds, basic life forms are more complicated than evolution can ever hope to address. Evolutionists like to say that changes take place over time. What they don't say is that that change has boundaries. So they slip in the concept that a tadpole can ultimately become a monkey that can ultimately become a PhD, but that change has limitations, and that change never leads to a higher order. It never increases the complexity. It might isolate the gene pool or get a superior product temporarily, but you have not increased the complexity. You have only limited the viability. Change over time is limited, and the final product is always downhill. To put this concept to simple terms, you can breed dogs, horses, and cows and get changes within those species. But at the end of the day, there are still dogs, horses, and cows. Mankind, with all its intelligence, can breed a dog to become a cow. Can't breed a dog to become a cow. Or a monkey to become a man. Change is limited to variations within the specific species. If it can't be done on purpose with intelligent thought and design, then it certainly can't happen accidentally, right? Scripture backs this up. The Lord said in Genesis 1:11 that the grass and the herbs were to bring forth after their kind. In Genesis 1:21, all the sea creatures and fowl of the air brought forth after their own kind. Genesis 1:24-25 states, and God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after its kind, cattle and creeping thing, and beast of the earth after his kind. And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and the cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after this his kind. And God saw that it was good. God saw, God even made creeps, right? Every creepy thing. I've heard that a lot. Scripture clearly teaches that each species reproduces after its own kind. According to the command of God, it's impossible for one species to evolve into another species. For those who believe in the authority of the Bible, that kills evolution. But sadly, many Christians don't let the Bible get in the way of what they believe, right? That is so true. I believe in devolution. I believe in devolution. I can see in nature, and I see in the Bible where humanity and other forms of have gone from complex to simple and from order to disorder. For instance, I believe that Adam was incredibly smart. It is said that people only use about 10% of their brain. I have no way of knowing, but they came to that conclusion. How they came to that conclusion. I don't know how they would measure that, but you can measure almost anything nowadays. I think these people may use a lot of less than 10%, but I do believe that Adam was hitting on all cylinders. God created man to be incredibly smart. Got it? We are super smart. You're a know-it-all. Did you know that? Y'all are know-it-alls because it's true. It's true. Y'all are all know-it-alls because you have Christ living in you. You have the mind of Christ. And he has the answer to every problem. He has the solution to every difficulty. He has a way out. He'll tell you what to do and how to do it. So you're a know-it-all. You just have to tap into that. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Adam was able to name every animal on earth. Their names are so descriptive of their function and how they live. This shows incredible intelligence on Adam's part. I believe that Adam and Eve were super smart, and I believe that we've all evolved downward from there. Amen. Evolution says that people came from apes, and they started out as cavemen who had no sophistication. Yet if you look at the oldest skeletons we have of mankind, they show incredible sophistication. Amen. I also believe that we used to have much deeper revelation of God. Adam and Eve walked with God in perfection, and Adam lived to be 930 years old. Can you imagine 930? That's a lot. Adam had an intimate relationship with God and saw the creation in its perfection. Then he began to see the animals start to prey upon each other, where in the beginning they were all herbivorous. Enoch also walked with God and had such a close relationship with him that he was literally caught up into heaven. Genesis 5:24. He never died. He never lived for over 300 years. The revelation of God that Adam and Enoch passed on impacted people. People started out knowing God. Cain, when he killed Abel, spoke directly to God in Genesis 4:9-16. They were having an audible face-to-face confrontation. People started out knowing that there was a God, but we have devolved. When people say there is no God, that's reverse evolution. It's foolish. It goes against their intuitive knowledge. Romans 1, verse 18 to 20. And we're going to read here Psalms 14:1-3. Psalms 14 says, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none that does good. The Lord looked down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there were any that did understand and seek God. They are all gone aside. They are all together become filthy. There is none that does good, no, not one. On the scriptures, the type goes down real tiny, I can hardly see. But that is, it's just so awesome, you know, when you hear it, when you're in the presence of the Lord or you're having your devotional and or you're praying to the Lord, and then that you can, you know, you hear him speaking back to you, and he's, you know, just talking back to you. That is an awesome feeling, and just to be in that presence. But can you imagine that Adam and Eve, they walked with the Lord daily, and to me, every day was a beautiful day, and but we have that too, because Christ lives in us, so we have him with us. But we're so busy in our world and just so overwhelmed a lot of times, we don't hear his voice, and we don't take time to just sit aside and hear what he's saying to us. Amen. According to verse 1 in Psalms 14, which is repeated in Psalms 53, only a fool would say there is no God. Only a fool could look at creation and not figure out that this incredible complexity could not possibly evolve. Take one of the simplest things in nature, a single blade of grass. If you pulled all the intellectual and financial resources of mankind, we could not produce a single living blade of grass. We could produce something that looks like grass. It might have the same texture and chemical makeup, but it couldn't reproduce itself. It wouldn't be alive. Amen. If man with all his intelligence can't do that which is least, then how can anyone possibly believe that the incredible complexity of nature could happen randomly? That defines logic. The chances of evolution happening randomly are impossible. The chances of a 747 jet being perfectly assembled and able to fly as a result of a bomb going off at the Boeing aircraft factory are infinitely more probable than the chances of evolution. The chances of an explosion in a print shop creating perfectly printed, bound, and stacked Bibles are infinitely more probable than any chances of evolution. If spacecraft discovered a house on Mars, I guarantee that people would see this as proof that there was once life on that planet. They wouldn't think this house just evolved. Only an intelligent creature could create something like that. Yet so-called intellectuals look at the complexity of nature and think it just evolved. That's foolish. Perhaps you're reading this and acknowledging that you don't fully believe in evolution to the point where you think the earth is here by accident, but you have bought into some of the other theistic theories of evolution. In this case, you still have mixed truth with lies and have adopted a secular worldview of how the earth was made. This is damaging to your faith. If you can't accept the word at face value, but instead mix other ingredients with it, your faith will become compromised. Satan can then easily get you to doubt the integrity of the rest of God's word. This puts everything you believe about the Bible at risk. Biblical creationism, which follows the whole truth of Scripture, is also called the young earth theory by scientists. It holds that the earth and every living creature were made by a creator in a period of 6 days, just as stated in Genesis 1. Based on these verses, creation covered a span of 6 days, literal days, because each had a morning and an evening, and because this is in the same type of day referred to in Exodus 20, verse 8 to 11, where the Sabbath is discussed. Jesus confirmed that humans were created at the same time as the earth, without millions of years separating them. When he said, from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. Mark 10:6, any other view of creation is, in some form, a compromise of what Scripture teaches. It's true. Dr. Grady McMurtry wholeheartedly believes in young earth theory. But this was not always the case. Dr. McMurtry grew up learning evolution in the public schools of Berkeley, California. He also spent time in the paleontology, thank you for all my school teachers in the house, labs of University of California, Berkeley, learning about dinosaur fossils and evolutionary theory as a child. He learned so much that when he was only 8 years old, teachers started borrowing him from one classroom to another to teach other kids. He ultimately went on to earn his MS from State University of New York in evolutionary theory, which he later taught. But when McMurtry was 27, the Holy Spirit guided him through scripture and proved to him that Jesus was who he said he was, and he became a Christian. He immediately recognized that he couldn't reconcile what he was reading in the Bible about creation with his evolution background. After 16 months of study and research, he came to the conclusion that there is not one law of science or one natural process that sufficiently supports evolution, whereas every natural law, every natural process, and all of the earth's physical evidence supports creation. Amen. Now, after decades of continued research, McMurtry travels the world educating people on the case for a young earth. Whether you look in the earth, on the earth, or outside the earth in space, there is plenty of evidence to show the earth is young, he argues. In fact, McMurtry states that there are over 270 geochronometers or earth time clocks that demonstrate a recent creation of the universe. For example, minerals and gemstones found inside the earth are said by evolutionists to take millions of years to form. But Dr. McMurtry has found evidence of gold being formed in fewer than 5 hours and states that in 2006, it was discovered how to produce flawless diamonds in fewer than 12 hours. McMurtry also points to stalagmites, which supposedly take millions of years to grow, having formed on Mayan pottery made in AD 700 as evidence of a young earth. My own study found that granite contains a radioactive particle called polonium-214, having a half-life of 0.000164 seconds. That means this radioactive particle dissipates in less than 1/1000th of a second. If it took more than 1/1000th of a second for granite to form, polonium-214 wouldn't be trapped in the rock. Dr. McMurtry also views the decay of the Earth's magnetic field as further evidence of a young Earth. Earth's decay has been measurable since the early 1800s. The Earth decays in the same way that radioactive material does, meaning it has a half-life. The half-life of Earth's magnetic field is 1,400 years. So every 1,400 years, one half of the strength of the magnetic field decays. Going back to in time, 1,400 years, the strength of this field would double. Our magnetic field bends the sun's radiation at the poles, and without it, everything on Earth would die. 10,000 years ago, the strength of the field would have killed all life on Earth. Therefore, living beings couldn't have been here millions of years ago, as old Earth theorists claim. Yet the further we move ahead in time, the weaker the field becomes. Within 2,000 years, our current magnetic field will be gone. As Dr. McMurtry put it, we live in a very narrow band of time. This is why we know that Jesus is coming back soon, because when he comes, there will still be people on earth. That means the field has to still be strong enough to shield the earth from the sun's radiation. God never intended the earth to last a long time once it became flawed due to human sin. What absolutely convinces Dr. McMurtry of a young earth is the evidence he's seen in the world's rock formations, along with sediment that has formed in the mouths of rivers across the globe. He thoroughly believes these things point to a global event of catastrophic proportions that very quickly damaged the face of the earth, an event that perfectly harmonizes with the flood in the Bible. The following is taken from an interview conducted with Dr. McMurtry, where he explains the findings. And I think we'll probably stop right there, and then we'll go through his findings. This is a very long chapter. It's like 40 pages long. And there's going to be some pictures, but it's going to start to talk about his findings, and there's some pictures in there that we're going to be looking at. There's a museum on the earth, on creation, here in Texas somewhere. I think they refer to it in this book. But it'd be interesting to go and look. They have, you know, rocks and formation, and they tell you all the history and all that kind of stuff. Those who like to do. To me, it seems kind of interesting. It'd be interesting to see and why they think that it's a young earth and not, you know, see all the evidence and not that it's millions of years old, but current. Amen? To prove. So, we're going to thank you. Thank you for being in the Bible study. We're going to take an offering right now. And we're going to continue our lesson next week. It's interesting, you know, of everything we're reading and evolution. I don't really know a lot about evolution because I try not to study anything I know it's not true or that I don't believe it. If it's not in the Word, I'm not going to take my time or waste my time looking into it. But I guess we do need to know so that we can stand up to people that are wrong or that are thinking wrong, you know. Like the atheists, you know, they believe in oh God, and, you know, we need to minister to those people. So it's good to know. And so thank you for being at this class where we're all learning together and growing. Amen. And while you prepare your offerings, the announcements for this week, it's really, we just Sunday, be here Sunday. Let's see, this Sunday is the last Sunday of the month, right? So we'll be having a women's meeting pretty soon, second Saturday in July, right? We didn't. So it's coming up pretty soon. Oh, the guys, the young people are going to camp. And once it's signed up, I think it's Will and Whitney's little boy. I forget his name. Yeah, and Todd's going to be their chaperone. So they're going to be going to that. So be in prayer for them. I think it starts Wednesday, next Wednesday. And then we'll be back here on Wednesday for Bible study, continue learning, see what Dr. McMurtry has to say. Okay, let's pray for our tithes and offering. Thank you, Father, for this evening, Lord. Thank you for your word. Father, thank you for creation. And Lord, we're just so grateful, Father, for your love and your mercy and your grace, Father, and that we're learning all these new things about our earth and about evolution and creation, Father, that we would get these teachings rooted in our heart, Father, so that we would know how to minister to those, Father, that believe that there is no God. So, Lord, I thank you also for these offerings that we're about to
Take, Father, that you bless each and every one that gives this night, tonight, Lord, that you bless them, bless their jobs, bless their retirement funds, bless their businesses, Father. And we thank you, Lord, that they're faithful givers and you're blessing them back a hundredfold. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you, Lord.